Hello, my name is Albano Meli. I'm a member of the Scientists of Tomorrow, and I'm very pleased today to welcome Professor Kristin Seidman for cardiovascular research on life interviews. So welcome, Professor Seidman, and thank you for sharing your thought with us today. So we can start with the first question. What is your key milestone discovery in your medical career?
Well, I think that I would probably rank the discovery of the first gene in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy as a turning point in my career. And that was because it showed myself and hopefully the world that the use of genetics to understand the molecular basis of an enigmatic disorder, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, was a valuable approach. And it allowed us then to use that same approach again and again to make other discoveries about the molecular basis for heart muscle diseases. Understanding those fundamental causes allows one to build models and then to really probe mechanism. But until you have that first step of a gene that you know is responsible when mutated, you can't go forward with mechanism. So I'd call that probably the most important discovery.
Thank you. So the second question, you have substantially contributed to a better understanding of the mechanism of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, its treatment and diagnosis. So how can we prevent it now?
Well, prevention is really right now trying to mitigate or reduce the biophysical abnormalities that we know these mutations cause. As a class, these genes interact in the sarcomere, and they perturb the contractility of the sarcomere in a very peculiar way. They actually increase the contractility and power of the sarcomere, but they reduce the ability of the sarcomere to fully relax. And as a consequence, that expends quite a bit of energy. So knowing that from a mechanistic point of view has allowed us to do small molecule screens to then identify a molecule that would reduce contractility a little bit, but far more importantly, to promote full relaxation of the heart. And so when we use that small molecule initially in cells and subsequently in whole animals, in mice that carry human mutations, we then can begin to understand that by normalizing these biophysical abnormalities, that you can reduce the development of hypertrophy, and with that, the development of myocyte death that leads to fibrosis. Those two combinations, we think, will be very fruitful going forward in patients. And today, a company, MyoKardia, has developed those small molecules into a drug, mavacamten, that is in clinical trials. So we're very hopeful that by understanding mechanism, we now have a molecular strategy to target and a drug that may be very beneficial in attenuating the abnormalities caused by these gene mutations. Over time, we'll see if that reduces symptoms and adverse outcomes in patients.
Thank you. So now the last question. What is your opinion about the potential of the iPS-derived cardiomyocyte coming from patients?
Yes. I think iPS cells are an enormous breakthrough that has really revolutionized cardiac biology and research. We don't have access to any cell lines from human hearts. Hearts rarely get cancers, and there is to date no verified continuous beating myocardial cell derived from a ventricular myocardium that we could study the biology. But with an iPS cell that's derived from a blood sample, we can make beating cardiomyocytes in a dish from patients or from a healthy individual, and then to manipulate the DNA in that beating cell so that it will carry any mutation we want. The advantage of the latter strategy allows us to have two identical beating cardiomyocytes, one with a precise mutation and the exact same genetic background but without the mutation, for comparative analyses. This is incredibly important and beneficial to understanding the biology of human heart disease. But in addition, I think it allows us to use these cells to make tissues so that we don't only have to study cells in a dish, but we can make micro strips of cardiomyocardial tissues. And using that, we certainly can learn a whole lot, not only about contractility at a cellular level, but the whole mechanics of muscle biology in micro tissues. This has revolutionized our science, and I think provides real opportunities going forward to do drug screens and analysis that will more quickly allow us to move to the clinic. There are hindrances to that today because the cells are not fully mature, but there are many teams working to try and advance the maturation. But even with the way they exist today, I think they are an incredible opportunity that our laboratory and many like your own continue to use with productive science resulting from them.
Thank you, Professor Sundmeier.
You're very welcome.
And thank you to our viewers.